Travis County District Courts. And let me begin by saying Happy New Year. So that was kind of sad. Let's try it again. Happy New Year! That's how we do it here in the Travis County Civil Courts. We are a festive and jolly group. I want to begin by having each of you please acknowledge this amazingly diverse and beautiful group of hardworking judges who do what they do on behalf of you. To all of my judicial colleagues, I want to welcome you to this swearing-in ceremony. I know that Judge Soifer appreciates your presence, and I appreciate your taking time off your busy dockets to be here to support our newest jurist. I can assure all of you, and certainly to Judge Soifer, that public service is a stimulating, proud, and lively enterprise. It is not just a way of life, it is a way to live life fully. And here at Travis County Civil Courts, I assure you, Judge Soifer, that you will find it stimulating, you will be proud to do this work, and it will not be dull. I would now like to introduce to all of you Rabbi Steve Folberg from Congregation Beth Israel, who will administer the invocation. Rabbi Folberg.
It's the honor of going first. Jan, I am so honored that you asked me to be with you for this extraordinary occasion, thereby honoring not only your installation as a Travis County District Court judge, but also honoring your connection to Judaism and to our synagogue congregation, Beth Israel. It is my intention to offer an invocation that honors those things, but is also inclusive of the diverse backgrounds of all of you who are in attendance this afternoon. And it's my prayer that all of you feel embraced and included today. We know that Hebrew scripture in general, and the Torah in particular, are obsessed with justice, especially obsessed with the way that those who have power treat those who are powerless. That is why the Torah and the prophets repeatedly call our attention to the vulnerability of the stranger, the widow, and the orphan. The whole of society is to be judged by how the weakest and most vulnerable are treated. That scriptural concern is distilled into a brief blessing that Jews recite at every weekday service. Indeed, traditional Jews recite the following blessing 3 times a day. And it is in the words of this blessing that I would like to wrap our hopes and our prayers for you today, Jan. I'll recite the Hebrew and then translate, and if you're comfortable, you are welcome to respond with an amen. The Hebrew sounds like this. Al shoftei eretz shefoch ruchacha v'hadrichem b'mishpatei tzidkecha u'meloch aleinu ata levadecha b'chesed uv'rachamim baruch ata Adonai ohev tzedaka u'mishpat, which means, pour out your spirit upon the judges of our land. Guide them in rulings that reflect your justice, and may you alone reign over us in mercy and loving kindness. Blessed are you, God, who loves justice and righteousness. And we say, amen.
Thank you. It's now my pleasure to welcome Leslie Dipple, who is the president of the Austin Bar Association, to the podium.
May it please the court. Nearly every single court. That was so beautiful, I feel a little unworthy to be following it. But on behalf of the Austin Bar Association, let me just welcome you and thank you for being here. It is my distinct pleasure to be here on behalf of the bar and welcome the investiture of Jan Soifer. I first met Judge Soifer when I was a law clerk at the Attorney General's office. She was so kind to me as a brand new law student, answering my endless questions, and I've never forgotten that. Our connection grew as I watched her in leadership with the Austin Bar. She was president of the Austin Young Lawyers Association. She was president of the Austin Bar Association. She was later elected to the State Bar. And through the many years that we will not add up, she's been very supportive of me as I started on a similar path, and I thank you so much for that, answering more endless questions. Thank you. She has, of course, had a very successful legal career with her law firm and as former chair of the Texas Democratic Party. Thank you for that service. We are so blessed in this beautiful city to have this judiciary that is so generous with your time. I look around the room and I don't see one that doesn't say yes every time the Bar Association calls. And I just want to thank you for that. And I know that Judge Soifer will follow in that because it's in her heart. We would not have a successful of Bar Association or frankly as much fun without your support and participation. But as I was looking for some meaningful words to commemorate today and came up short, I did what any good lawyer does, I hit the books. And I found these words from author Shannon Alter. There comes a time in your life when you can no longer put off choosing. You have to choose one path or the other. You can live safely and be protected by those just like you, or you can stand up and be a leader for what is right. Always remember this. People never remember the crowd. They remember the one person that had the courage to say and do what no one else would. Judge Soifer, I cannot think of more appropriate words to describe you. Thank you for your leadership, and it will be such a privilege to turn this podium around and address you as an attorney while you're sitting on the bench. Welcome to all of you, and thank you for joining Judge Soifer in this meaningful ceremony.
Our next speaker is no stranger to this courtroom or to this community. Please welcome the Reverend Joseph C. Parker, Jr.
May it please the court. It's been a long time since I have been able to say that, and I'm delighted to be here today. Some 38 years ago, I was gifted with someone who would become a lifelong friend. That person was Jan Soifer. When we started law school, University of Texas, we were divided into the same section. And somehow she and I ended up being in the same constitutional law class and decided that we wanted to be study partners. It was from that moment that our nefesh, our souls, were knitted together. There's much I could say about that friendship. And Jan is one who has given flesh to one of my favorite biblical passages, Proverbs 17 and 17, which says that a friend loves at all times and a brother or sister is born for adversity. Our 38 years or so journeying together has involved times of love and times of challenge. We have been consistent in our friendship. It has been a delight and a joy for me to travel with Jan over these years, getting to know her family, getting other friends along the way, such as Rabbi Folberg, who is a dear friend. Jan and I have crossed a lot of barriers in this city together. When there were issues related to the Jews and blacks, we had dialogue between Jewish and Christians. When there were some unfortunate statements made by Reverend Jesse Jackson, Jan called me together and we sat down to make sure that we would not have disunity among our communities. As a result of that, Jan also opened up doors where, believe it or not, a black Baptist preacher was allowed to preach from the pulpit of Congregation Beth Israel because of the friendship she allowed me to develop with her rabbi, Steve Folberg. And even more recently, we have partnered together in that the youth of his congregation were concerned about the issues related to Black Lives Matter and asked that our youth would come and engage them in conversation. We have bridged the Jewish and Christian communities in a delightful way. Not only that, but Allie, Jan's daughter, asked me to participate in her bat mitzvah at Congregation Beth Israel. And I've got to know and love Pat and Brad. So you can see that I've traveled a long way. I've been her treasurer in her political campaigns. And we just live on the other side of 2222 from each other. Somehow God has knitted us. And it's been a great, great, great journey. One of the things that I can say is when Jan and I first met and we were in our study group together studying constitutional law, which is the sort of subject the lawyers know that allows you to see a person's innards. It allows you to discuss some controversial, sensitive, tough issues. And Jan and I were able to have conversations that allowed me to see who she is beneath the skin. That has been consistent. The person I met in 1979 is the person I know today. I've walked with her all the way. I've supported her all the way. And I have come to know her to be a person of integrity, of compassion, of commitment, and of action. That's who I know her to be. That's who I expect her to continue to be. I'm looking forward to her dispense justice from her courtroom. I enjoy the privilege to now refer to her as Judge Jan Soifer. My friend, my sister, thank you for this opportunity to be a part of a wonderful celebration.
It's wonderful to be here and to see so many old friends. I remember when I was sworn in by Judge Jerry Delano back in January 1995, and it seems like just yesterday that occurred. I've had the honor to know Jan Soifer for not quite 38 years, but going on 30, and she is a dear, dear friend, a respected colleague in the legal profession, and I'm delighted that she is going to be presiding over the 345th District Court here in Travis County. And at this time, I will administer the oath of office to her. Jan, if you will come forward, please. I guess Reverend Parker found it. He didn't need it. All right. Raise your right hand, please. I, Jan Soifer.
I, Jan Soifer.
Do solemnly swear or affirm.
Do solemnly swear or affirm.
That I will faithfully execute the duties.
That I will faithfully execute the duties.
Of the office of District Judge, 345th District.
Of the office of District Judge, 345th District.
Of the State of Texas.
Of the State of Texas.
And will to the best of my ability.
And will to the best of my ability.
Preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution and laws.
Preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution and laws.
Of the United States and of this state.
Of the United States and of this state.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Mazel tov.
Wow. Thank you, Judge Covington, for administering the oath and for your kind words, and to everyone who participated today. Judge Livingston, Rabbi Fulberg, Leslie Dipple, and Reverend Parker, I so appreciate your support and kind words. And thank you all for being here. As you might imagine, I've gotten a lot of advice from people during my first week here at the courthouse. They tell me that I should tell you you should see the other guy, or that these injuries show how far I'll go in fighting justice. Probably the best advice was that I should wear a veil today, but as you can see, I ignored that. Instead, my daughter made me an appointment with an amazing makeup artist this morning. Thank goodness for Jocelyn at Sephora. So let me get this out of the way. It's true, I fell face first in a parking lot downtown on Wednesday. Anyone know a good lawyer? If you want to see the before photo before the makeup artist, I'll show you if you don't get queasy. But no, I was not texting and walking, the first thing my sister asked me. And no, I wasn't wearing 5-inch heels. I just wasn't paying attention, and I tripped in a pothole. I appreciate everyone's sympathy and concern. But here's the good news. I figure that since I literally fell on my face during my first week as a judge, that should immunize me from figuratively falling on my face. I want to introduce and thank some of the people who are here for me today, other than the folks you've already met. My family, my husband Pat, with whom I'll be celebrating our 33rd anniversary later this month. Pat has been my law partner and best friend, and without him, first of all, I'm not going to make it through this. We'll just get, but I wouldn't be here. And our wonderful kids who we are so proud of. Brad, who is in a teacher certification program right now and will be teaching science in a low-performing AISD high school soon. And Allie, who worked on the advanced team for Vice President Joe Biden and for the Hillary Clinton campaign and is now unexpectedly unemployed. but we know she'll land on her feet. Brad and Allie and, of course, Pat have been 100% behind me, and I appreciate and love them so much. My mom, Fannette Soifer, who is here from Houston and who, along with my dad, always made me believe I could be whatever I wanted to be and taught me to believe in myself, which made it possible for me to go to Yale when not many women did, to go to UT Law when only about a third or so of our class were female, to go into litigation with what was then the largest firm in Austin at a time when I was the first and that there weren't very many women doing that, and to being here today. My sister Carrie and her husband Harvey and son Zach in Austin are also here from the Houston area, which I really, really appreciate, along with our cousins Rick and Ann Frockman. My cousins and dear friends Bob and Sherry Frockman and Jason and Jen Haas with their kids are all here. My brother-in-law Mike O'Connell and his wife Kathy, my sisters-in-law Elizabeth Walker and Meg Land, they have been my family for the past 33 years. And Pat's cousins Tim and Martha O'Connell and Barb Crowder and her son Sean, who's here with his significant other, Jenny. In addition to them, there are friends who are here from literally all over the country. My friends and fellow whistleblower lawyers who have been so supportive of me, especially those who traveled to be here from Los Angeles, Mark Kleiman and Stephanie Fletcher, who came here from New York by way of Florida, Leslie Skillen and her husband, Larry. Chicago, Linda Weisner and her daughters Sarah and Maya. My dear friends Deborah and Scott Coldwell are here from Dallas. I know my former co-counsel from the Center for Reproductive Rights, Stephanie Todi and David Brown, are both here from New York. A former client, Michelle Muncy, president of the King Foundation, is here from Dallas. My former law partner and friend Rob Wiley is here with Carol from the Woodlands. I saw Rob back here somewhere. There you are. Elected officials, judges, so many of the people I admire the most are here. And those who supported and served as my mentor. And I want to especially mention Senator Kirk Watson, who sent his regrets that he couldn't be here today. But Chuck Herring, who was, the two of them are both former Travis County Democratic Party chairs who unfailingly supported me as chair and in this race. And I will never forget that. There are a number of other elected officials here today, which I really appreciate, who are friends and people I admire. District Clerk Velva Price. County Clerk Dana de Beauvoir. County Attorney David Escamilla, also in my law school class. Sheriff Sally Hernandez. Constable Carlos Lopez. Tax Assessor Collector Bruce Elfont. And hopefully I didn't miss anybody. Oh, Margaret's here. Margaret, I didn't see you. My dear friend Margaret Moore, the new DA, who also happens to be Allie's godmother. And Robert. Well, I'm going to talk about them in a minute. My special longtime friends who are here for me when I need them. We won't talk about the number of years, but it's close to Joe. Sean Jamil, Delaine Ward, Laura Ingerson, Sarah Goodfriend, and Suzanne Bryant, and so many of you all who are here. The Travis County Democratic Party staff who made me look so good while I was chair, J.D. Ginn, Cindy Flint, and Joe Deshotel. Robert Oliver, I told you I'd get to him. My mentor and supervisor when I was a new lawyer at what was then the Brown Moroney firm. And his wife, our new DA, Margaret, who, as county attorney and a specially deputized assistant district attorney, was the first woman I ever saw handle a jury trial. And as I mentioned, Margaret and Robert are Allie's godparents. Judge Will Flowers, who I see hiding back there in the back instead of up here with the judges, he asked me to serve as his campaign treasurer. I think it was 88 when he first ran, and he served as a political mentor and friend to me, and his wife Simone Talma Flowers, who's the executive director of Interfaith Action of Central Texas, with whom I worked closely when I was on that board. Judge Jim Coronado, who also honored me, who's also hiding in the back, by asking me to be his campaign treasurer. There are so many other former judges and judges here that I admire, but I want to especially mention, of course, Suzanne Covington and Judge Paul Davis, both of whom came from Taos to be here, and my predecessors on the 345th, Stephen Yelenoski and Scott McCown. These are judges I aspire to emulate, along with all of the judges you see here. And whose support and guidance over the years I so appreciate. And I want to thank my fellow judges who have already been so supportive of me and so kind to me. And I look forward to working with you all, and I have so much admiration for all of you, including especially my dear friend and administrative judge Laura Livingston, who models devotion to access to justice. My campaign team is here. Campaign manager Joe Bowen, consultants Katie Naranjo, Mark Nathan, and Susan Hari, who I know is out of town, David Butts, and so many of you who volunteered and supported me on that campaign. It just means so much to me. I also want to introduce you to my court staff. Court reporter Albert Alvarez, also hiding in the back. I had a jury trial in the mid-80s in the 345th under its original judge, Juan Gallardo, And Albert was the court reporter then and had been court reporter before this court was created in 1983. And I'm thrilled that Albert is staying on after Judges Gallardo, McCown, and Yelenowski. He's the only court reporter who's ever served the 345th, and I'm so lucky to have him. My quarter operations officer, Claire Webb, who's probably also hiding somewhere in the back. Claire was a great hire by Judge Yelenowski, who I'm very happy is staying on. And my new staff lawyer, Elliot Beck, who I can tell you after this first week, I already know is going to be a huge asset to the 345th. And now I'm inclined to ask all of you who I haven't mentioned to stand up and be recognized. But seriously, there's food and drink waiting for us at the Highland Lounge, and I want us to be able to get over there soon. So let me just say this. I am very fortunate to have practiced law here in Travis County for the past 34 years, and to have the advantage of appearing before smart, fair, and outstanding judges, and to work with the very collegial lawyers of this county. In my experiences with cases outside of this county, not all judges are this good, and not all lawyers behave themselves as well as ours. I appreciate your support and your confidence in me. I promise to do my best to be a judge in the tradition of great Travis County judges like the ones here today. I promise I will work hard every day to be a fair, impartial, patient, and thoughtful judge, and to be respectful of everyone who appears in my court, to listen and to make sure that everyone feels heard, and to make you proud that you supported me. In return, I will expect the lawyers who appear in my court to be respectful and professional, and to act in accordance with the Texas Lawyers Creed, which I already have hanging in my courtroom. I am so grateful that all of you are here supporting me, and I hope that you'll all join us at the Highland Lounge immediately after this ceremony, where we have some great food, courtesy of the Austin Bar and my campaign, and some wonderful sponsors are buying the first round of drinks. See you there, and thanks again for being here.
Well, that first quote I left you with was from former Congressman Lee Hamilton, the one about public service. I leave you now with one from Woodrow Wilson. He said that you are not here merely to make a living. You are here in order to enable the world to live more amply, with greater vision, with a finer spirit of hope and achievement. You are here to enrich the world, and you impoverish yourself if you forget the errand. So Judge Soifer, don't forget the errand. Do your best. We will all be here to support you and do our best to make your stay here in Travis County Civil Courts the best experience that you could imagine. You will love this job, we all do, and we are grateful that you have joined this amazing judiciary in this community, and we want to thank everyone here. Enjoy.